Well, up first on the show, let's get you the latest numbers. And with a positivity rate of 8.06%, India reported 90,123 new cases, taking its COVID case tally past the 50 lakh mark. The country also reported 1,290 deaths in the last 24 hours, and that's the highest in a day. So it took 230 days for India to hit the 50 lakh mark, with the country recording more than 90,000 new cases every day for the past week, barring Tuesday. Maharashtra remains the worst affected state by the pandemic, with a tally of 10.7 lakh cases, and close to half the cases, that's 48.8% of active cases, are concentrated in three states: Maharashtra, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. More than 37% of the cumulative deaths reported so far in the country are from Maharashtra. So let's take a look at how fast we arrived at this 5 million mark. It took 169 days for us to reach that first million. And between the fourth and the fifth million, it took us just 11 days to jump from that number. It took us 13 days to get from 3 million to 4 million and 21 days to arrive at that second million. So just 11 million between the 4 million and 5 million mark. More worrying, as we see the cases increasing exponentially, is that cases are now going to rural parts of the country, to rural India, where the health infrastructure is anyway very, very fragile. And there's a whole set of different challenges there. To talk more about this, we're now joined by Dr. Tanmay Mahapatra, an epidemiologist who works with Care India in Patna. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us on the show today. So with the cases rising in this manner exponentially, as is being said, the big crisis is the spread of the disease to rural India, and there already, you, as I mentioned, health services are very weak. How do you see this playing out? What are the challenges that you are seeing?
So, although starting from 30th January, when the case first time this found in India, since then it actually gradually affected different metros, but in the parallel, that spread continued to happen. Now, the challenges that you are asking for is, whenever we are talking about COVID, we have a smaller fraction of the cases where we have the requirement of advanced therapeutics and different kind of infrastructural support to treat those seriously ill patients with ventilator support and different kind of critical care. That is a big concern definitely for those cases, because in our rural areas, we don't often see this kind of that kind of infrastructure available. But the bigger concern is, even if they are not critically ill, still, unless we have the awareness and kind of the situation which is required to have them either institutionally or at home, isolated properly and kept under proper surveillance system to understand whom we can treat adequately at home and whom we need to admit in an institution to give the first level or second level support, like starting from oxygenation up to other kind of things, and whom we need to actually transfer to the next level. So that kind of infrastructural challenge is the biggest challenge. Across the country, over time, differentially across states, these things have been taken care of. But still, in such a country with such an exponential growth, we have miles to go.
Right, absolutely, sir. And also another worry is, you know, the taboo around coronavirus. There's a, especially in rural India, there's almost like the stigma associated with the disease, and that causes many people, you know, they're reluctant to come forward. They don't want to get tested. So there clearly needs to be a push for more awareness.
Challenge definitely with the awareness, and that's more so in the village areas, because in the village areas, having the person who can develop that kind of awareness in the community, we generally have less availability and less access to those kind of opinion leaders and people who can aware others. But the taboo or whatever we say, that is rampant across the whole population. Even after 9 months of having this menace going on, it's really tough to handle thing concepts like whether hot water is going to prevent COVID transmission or not, whether any kind of particular religious or other kind of aspects are going to help in this scenario or not, with different kind of panic and stigma. These kind of things, even there is there across the cities also. Definitely in the rural areas, as people are more intermingled and kind of follow their opinion leaders, it has both sides actually. Like it is tough to access, but probably more easy to convince. So if we are dealing with right information and not information pollution, handling rural areas in a coordinated way with proper public health risk communication and communication management, the scenario can be better handled also in rural areas. So I see lack of awareness as a challenge, but generating awareness is less challenging in rural areas if we can actually use our frontline workers, self-help groups, and other kinds of different channels and platforms properly.
So there needs to be that push to generate awareness. Now, I want to bring up the whole question of testing because, you know, NDTV has found that according to official data, this is data that we've studied, the positivity rate difference between the two different methods of testing, that's antigen testing and RT-PCR testing, is only 2%. In fact, if we can just bring up that, you know, graphic of PCR versus antigen, it's only 2% of a difference at the All India number. Though usually, if we talk about RT-PCR testing, which is, you know, considered the gold standard, it should be double that rate. So if this is correct, in that case, we probably have a lot of false negatives and our daily count is much, much higher according to this. In fact, we're recording nearly 1 lakh case every single day. It could even be as high as 2 lakh or 2.5 lakhs.
Number one, you are completely right that it's about how the testing is being done. And that is true for many things. Suppose we are talking about nasal swab and throat swabs. Now, if we are using nasopharyngeal swab for the testing, that is considered to be more accurate in terms of capturing the required material as the biological sample. Now, somebody is coming to test me. What that person will prefer? Doing it through nasopharyngeal or throat swab? Because while doing it nasopharyngeally, there is a high likelihood that I'll sneeze. And this fomite-based direct transmission, there will be increased risk for the person who is testing. So there is actually a variation in type of testing that is being done through what kind of samples being taken. And then it is easier for the person who is testing to hand the swab stick over to me and ask me that you use it, you take and hand over. So self-testing, testing by the personnel, testing through the nasopharyngeal swab, testing through the throat swab, and then when are we testing? On which day of exposure? Now that is too impossible, completely impossible to understand, because when I got actually exposed, that is not it's not known to the person who is actually ultimately coming for the planning of testing or strategizing. We are dealing with a virus whose infectivity is very high, but pathogenicity is low. That's why what is happening, that 80 to 90% of the cases remaining mild symptomatic or asymptomatic. That season that we are dealing with, the population that we are dealing with, here we often have flu-like symptoms commonly occurring in this kind of the seasons as well as this part of the globe. Now, which particular sore throat is actually a symptom of COVID and what awareness and responsiveness that I have to get tested based on that, it depends on which day of exposure I am being tested and if at all tested. The access also changed over time. And based on all these uncertainties, there is a high likelihood that things will vary. So basically, comparing the positivity rate of antigen and RT-PCR and concluding which one is not being done correctly, I think this concept is little redundant. The other thing is, we definitely know there are issues. So what is actually more important is whether the strategy is being followed. That means those who are at high risk of contact, a job where high risk is a possibility, having symptoms and the symptoms suggestive of COVID, if they are tested through antigen testing and after that coming negative, are we properly going for RT-PCR for them or not? This is number one question. And number two, whether for RT-PCR, whether for antigen test, are we following the guideline fully? Is it implemented across different public private sector, urban rural settings, and different kind of scenarios, like when you are doing a mass testing or when you are doing individual testing? These kind of things are very much required to be understood.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Mahapatra, for joining us and talking about the importance of different types of testing and also the challenges in rural India.